So, my name's Brandon Chin, and I'm here with Sabo Shen, and today we're just talking a little bit about a little bit of everything, and we're trying to just show the process of becoming friends and just talking about stuff.
Yeah, and I guess I always like to do what I like to call the origin story, which is every time you watch like a Marvel movie,
yep.
And you know, they kind of give you that first 5 to 10 minutes of,
yeah.
Like, how did this person, you know, become this superhero?
Right, okay.
And I always thought that's the easiest way to, you know, get people to understand, like, why are they watching, who they're watching, and ultimately, like, why we're even sitting here. So I think a good place to start is, so interestingly enough, Brandon and I have only known each other since, I think, was it Tuesday or Wednesday night?
Tuesday night.
We have a common friend who I've done jiu-jitsu with for a couple of years now. His name is Gordon. Gordon is just an awesome guy. We can all agree upon that.
Mm-hmm.
And although Gordon and I have never hung out outside of jiu-jitsu, he somehow knew me well enough to think we would be good friends. And he texted me one night and said, "Hey, can I introduce you to my friend Brandon? I think you guys would get along." And I'm like, "Sure, let's all hang out." And then he replies, "Oh, that'd be great, but I'm leaving to Washington, like, tomorrow." And I was like, okay, well,
all right.
Now I gotta go meet this guy that a mutual friend introduced us to. And although, you know, I love Gordon a lot, like, you know, like I said, I only know him through jiu-jitsu,
mm-hmm.
So...
one aspect of him.
Exactly,
yeah.
Exactly. So I wasn't too sure exactly what to expect, but I think... in our first recording, I said this, we've decided to become lifelong friends.
Yep.
So, I guess, you know, for me, what was interesting was, and, you know, when we first met on Tuesday, I brought this up, was that you're the first Asian male that I know that I've ever asked, you know, let's do a podcast together, and I didn't need to twist your arm to do it. And I don't know, maybe for people watching, that doesn't seem like a very big deal, but considering I've been asking people for the last 5 years, and you're the first person to say yes, you know, I thought that was, I mean, it just, for no other reason than you saying yes, I was like, this is a guy that I think I want to get to know more of. And ultimately, I mean, I think we decided to do this podcast. You convinced me not to have a format or template, so where do we go from here?
Well, okay, I'll just start by telling a little bit about why I said yes to even having this conversation. I think for a lot of Asian Americans, we have this kind of struggle with identity, with do you identify as Asian or American or both or some other shape or form? And I think I had denied a lot of what made me proud to be an Asian for a long time because of assimilation to do well in this culture. And I actually denied a lot of the things that made me a cool person that actually attracted people to me. And, I mean, we all know who Bruce Lee is,
right?
You know, and he has definitely that cocky, confident, showy side to him, but he also acknowledges that he's aware of that. And there's also that part of him that's deeply philosophical. And I think that conversation about being representing the story of how our people came here and how we're doing in this world, like, you know, and how it's okay to talk about, you know, the vulnerabilities of just being a man, period, and then being an Asian American man. I think there's a lot of guys out there who they want to just feel like they're not alone.
Right, right. That makes a lot of sense. And, you know, I think fundamentally, even though I didn't have an idea of what this podcast would be, or when I asked people, let's do a podcast, you know, I never had like a real idea other than, you know, I thought the other person was interesting.
Mm-hmm.
And if we spoke about the stuff that we typically speak about, it would resonate with some people. But, you know, I think as you gave that explanation and you were talking about, like, suppressing the parts that really made you cool, you know, I think this goes back to when I was telling you about, like, the Asian male. The growing up as an Asian American male in America, I think, is a really weird thing because, you know, our counterpart, the Asian American female, is, like, the most prized possession of, like, all other men. And
that's so weird. Yeah.
Yeah. And then on the flip side is then you got the Asian male who, for all intents and purposes, I believe has been kind of emasculated by our society.
Yes,
you know,
sir.
Like when I saw Jet Li give Aaliyah like a handshake at the end of Romeo Must Die, or I think I think Jackie Chan maybe even got like a hug from Jennifer Love Hewitt, but I was just like, this is so odd that like, mm-hmm. even when we are the hero of the story, you know, we are never presented as like, you know, the object of desire. And I do believe it was because fundamentally I felt that way as a kid, that I was never myself up until probably well into my 30s, you know, and figuring that out. And like you said, you know, once I kind of figured that out and just let Sabo be Sabo, then it's like I didn't have to be cool anymore. It was just being myself was enough for the group that I was hanging out with.
And when I actually dropped the act, so to speak, that was a lot of it too was like I just identified as being an American Caucasian person in behavior, right? Like, you know, being able to be the center of attention, which is not really, that's very different for a lot of Asian men, to be okay with being that center of attention.
Right.
You know, or like, you know, like, oh, just keep quiet. Don't make trouble, you know? And I'm like, fuck that. Make some fucking trouble. But then when my ego was in charge, it was always about me making the trouble. It wasn't about, okay, what is the message that I want to send? And I think at the bottom of this is we're sending the message that it's okay to just be you.
Right, right. And I don't think this is specific to Asian males,
right,
or anyone. It's ultimately, you know, how do you be your authentic self or the best version of yourself, whatever mm-hmm. you want to call it. You know, I often wondered, like, if this is a millennial, like, thinking framework, or is this unique to you and I? Or do you see this being more of a generational thing? Or, you know, because for my parents, I think it was about survival,
yes.
you know? So
just bare survival.
So
yeah.
they're like, get a good job. Get something consistent, mm-hmm. either attorney, doctor, or engineer. Those three would be acceptable. And, you know, I often thought about, well, I was like, maybe not those three, but I wanted to be, like, rich, I think, to appease
sure.
them. But ultimately, you know, it was, I mean, it's, well, if you're just living to fulfill your parents' desires, that's one thing. But, you know, it did fundamentally kind of help me understand that as immigrants, you know, their heads were, how do we come to this new country and make a life? It wasn't about how do we find the job that fulfills me the most or,
right.
you know, anything along those lines. So it is an interesting paradigm shift to come from that generation and then try to talk about these things. So I guess, you know, you have some younger half siblings, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, do they kind of think the same way as you, where they want to be like their authentic selves, or are they still kind of chasing that, you know, I got to be the Bill Gates or the Mark Zuckerberg type of archetype?
I think that they are split down the middle. I think they want to, like, what's interesting is when I look back at why people enjoy, or I enjoy being in their life and they enjoy being in mine, is I give them permission to just be them. What my friend says, holding space. Now, in like self-development, like if I always go back to the Maslow's hierarchy of needs, like when you're your whole life is just about getting shelter because it's hard,
mm-hmm.
you know, you're at the base of the pyramid. And then now that like Asian people are so ingenious, like that documentary In Search of General Tso's Chicken talks about Chinese entrepreneurs, but we've elevated ourselves beyond that basic struggle. And now it's like, if you go up the ladder, it's about finding, you know, balance in your life, spirituality, those things that are the next level in development. And our ancestors, or the generation before, has killed the game. They just made it safe, you know. They got all this security and this money, but there's not a lot of fulfillment involved. That's the last thing talked about.
Yeah.
And people are very concerned about fulfillment because society makes it easy to get these resources. But now it's about fulfillment. I don't think it's a generational thing as much as a just a person thing, you know?
Right, right. So you think fundamentally if someone has all of their kind of survival needs taken care of, then they automatically start thinking about fulfillment.
Yeah, and there are people who, like, they still have to eat McDonald's. They have to drive 2 hours a day and they work 10 hours and they don't get to think beyond that. Whereas some people have that luxury to, or whatever it is, it could be situational, but coming from, you know, the Asian American story, my mom, and she was just financially responsible. You know, she didn't do things she liked to do. She just got the job done and raised me as a single mother.
Yeah.
You know, and I mean, did you have What did your parents kind of provide for you?
So my dad was an entrepreneur. My mom is also an entrepreneur.
Oh, interesting.
Sometimes good, sometimes bad, you know. Mm-hmm. So I kind of got to see like the pros and cons of being an entrepreneur. So, I mean, just kind of watching how they... And my mom's like a huge risk taker, you know, mm-hmm. like she...
Really?
Yeah, and...
That's different for Asian women to have risk taker.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, my mom's a pretty progressive lady, and, you know, just tangentially, like my mom's oldest sister, I don't know if I told you this story, but my mom's oldest sister, she left Taiwan in her mid-20s because she was trying to start a business. It was a very patriarchal society, so she went to Japan. Didn't speak any Japanese. I mean, Japan is also very male-dominated as mm-hmm. well, if not more. And she was able to become a multimillionaire, like, many times over. And what really impresses
right,
me about...
On.
Yeah, dude, what impresses me about her, and kind of something I want to see if I could pull off, but it's not as important to me, is she has three daughters, mm-hmm. and all three daughters married into families where the husband took their last name. That's how, like, big
what?
Of a G she
that's
is.
That's fucking progressive.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Audience, take note of that. That
yes.
That's progressive shit.
So, yeah, so my mother is her younger sister by, like, 15 years, and we kind of all kind of jokingly refer to as, like, the godmother of our family because
yeah.
we have, I mean, I have a bachelor's of arts in ethnic studies, and out of, like, both my parents on each side have five siblings each, so six total.
Holy crap.
So there's about 89 cousins.
Oh, my God.
And there's only
That's
three
crazy.
Boys. But not to digress, but almost everyone has an advanced degree,
sure.
you know, beyond a college degree.
Right.
So, you know, for me, just having a bachelor's, like, it was... you know, I always got the sense, like, it wasn't enough,
mm-hmm.
you know, and, you know, just having to, like, try to prove that, you know, scholastically I could have been at the same place. It was just weird, you know, but ultimately I think, you know, watching my parents being entrepreneurs and struggle with it, but have some sort of, like, freedom of, like, not being tied to the 9-to-5 desk, you know, was really appealing to me, and I think ultimately, like, why, you know, I became an entrepreneur myself.
What does that mean for, because entrepreneur is kind of a new term for a lot of people. I don't know if people use that, you know, back in the 90s or, you know, like, what does that mean today, like, in today's world? Because it's a word that gets tossed around a lot.
Yeah, you know, that's a really interesting question because I was talking to someone earlier about this being, like, the age of the fake entrepreneur.
Mm-hmm.
You know, just like CrossFit was kind of the thing a few years
man.
Ago.
I'm super guilty of some of the, like, entrepreneur, like, fake, what, I don't know, I just identify, anyway, go ahead.
It's all good. I mean, we all identify with certain things that we might not be super deep in, but I don't
mm-hmm.
think it matters as long as you're kind of in the practice of doing it. But there are a lot of people that have a company that will say they're a successful CEO that they haven't had, like, a big win yet, you know, and by big win, I mean, like, selling their company or having their company acquired or going public, you know, and not that that's the difference between a successful and an unsuccessful entrepreneur, but in business, it's pretty easy to keep score, you know, is your business thriving or is it dying, you know,
mm-hmm.
and there are a lot of people that have started something small, like, let's say, let's just say, like, a recycling service, right? The recycling service, you could say, I'm the CEO of this recycling service, and all you really do is bring your neighbor's cans to the recycling plant and do it on a weekly basis. You know, like, some people will say, I'm an entrepreneur, you know, and I would argue that they are kind of creative with what they're doing and figuring out a cool way to make money, but, you know, to define yourself as a, you know, if I was doing that, I would just say that's more of, like, this little hobby and thing that I'm doing on the side.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and when I think of entrepreneurship, I'm thinking of, you know, is this something you're dedicating, like, 50 to 60 hours a week into? You know, is it not just your time, but also you believe it enough to put your money in? You know, I, like, not that there's a set rule for what is, like, a true business owner or not, but
mm-hmm.
I think there are varying levels of dedication. And especially today where you could get, like, a website for $40, you know,
yeah.
SaboShen.com.
Yeah, Squarespace it and get some cool pictures
yes,
on
yes.
your iPhone. It's
exactly.
crazy.
And then there you go. You got your business, you know. And I know that when I first started out, it was hard for me to delineate the people that were like the fakers mm-hmm. from the people that were actual real entrepreneurs. And
yeah.
over the last 3 years, just through meeting all these different personality types, I started being able to, you know, just start, you know, not 100% accuracy, but, you know, 80% of the times, like, okay, this guy, he's probably just a big talker and, you know, just nod your head and move on. Whereas this other guy, okay, let's spend some more time with him and really figure out if there's some sort of partnership that could be had between our two companies. Because right now our company's like in a position where VapeXL is, we're not the biggest, we're not the smallest, but we are like one of the fastest rising companies. Mm-hmm. So there are a lot of people that want to kind of associate with that, just like the same way we wanted to associate with bigger companies so that we could kind of, you know, go along with their gravitational pull.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, at the end of the day, it's like if you have 10 people asking and you only have time for two, you know, you have to be, the only thing that I believe you could really control is how you spend your time. You know,
yes.
like how other people
yes.
react and stuff, like you can't control that. So, you know, the part that I could control, which is, all right, which guys do I give my time to? And I have to be, you know, I used to want to help everyone, but what I realized was if I value my time as much as the other people do, then we are both getting more out of it because...
Yes.
Yeah, it's hard to explain, you know.
The symbiotic relationship, like we have to, I think humans learn, the reason why we're at the top of the food chain is because we can learn from other animals and change our behavior. And when we study symbiotic relationships, they all benefit the environment. And so if we take a look at like humans, we have this... curse where we can kind of get trapped in our own bullshit and it's just only helping ourselves. That's easy, you know, you can do that, you can play that game for a long time, but the trickier part is to do things that, like, I forget where I'd read this, but somebody defined business as the art of relationship management. And I was like, it's not about money or commerce, that's just an exchange, but managing relationships. And I was like, oh man, what about the one with myself? Like, this whole thing with wellness and self-care, it comes along in the, like, the whole tech world too, and entrepreneurs, like, with burnout, you know, it's like, I work in fitness, and peripherally, like, helping people who are entrepreneurs, and successful ones by whatever definition, right? Like,
right.
In Silicon Valley, you know, successful companies, but the one key trait that they all had was they didn't know how to take care of themselves. Their own relationship, they couldn't justify spending 3 hours a week taking care of themselves.
Yeah.
It was extremely hard. And these are really smart, intelligent, capable of executing people. But still, like, there's this, I think that the dream of what is supposed to happen overtakes them.
Yeah. Well, I think, you know, if we go back to what we began the conversation with about the Asian males,
yes.
is, you know, you kind of build this story of, like, what you want to be,
uh-huh.
or how, like, when you're older, like, how you want to become.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, many times, as you're building the story in your head, it limits you in some ways, it motivates you in other ways. But, you know, what's interesting is, like you said, you know, you're training all of these people that are excellent at executing in the art of business, but for whatever reason are neglecting themselves. And ultimately, I do believe business is the art of relationship management.
Mm.
I mean, if it was a strict science, then everyone could be a great businessman,
right?
Go to
business school and get your degree.
Exactly,
as simple as that.
Exactly. And then it doesn't work that way. And what's interesting is I also know a lot of these really, like, highly, you know, when I say successful, I'm just talking about in monetary terms, at least in the context of this conversation. I define success a little bit more holistically, but you know, just for this conversation, you know, a lot of these guys successful, you know, millionaires many times over, and, you know, like you said, they're not taking care of themselves. Many times I ask them, well, are you happy, you know? And
yeah.
they give me this, like, confused response, and it's almost like it's the first time they're thinking about whether or not they are happy. And I remember before I started my own venture, I was lucky enough to work for 5 separate companies that had these successful exits and really watch, you know, how you take a company of 5 people, grow it to 50, to 250, and then ultimately sell it. And, I mean, it's just a really interesting way to, it very much mirrors, like, raising a kid, except, you know, this kid has multiple personalities because of all the different
right.
Personalities involved in a company. But ultimately, what I realized was for a lot of these people, that were really driven, that made like huge advances in the professional world, it was at the expense of either their personal lives or their spirituality, and really kind of living something really unbalanced and being rewarded, you know, by society, by the newspapers, by, you know, being on TV or the internet. And I think in a weird way that, I mean, I could have been going down that trap, but luckily, you know, I think I smoke a lot of cannabis. I got a lot of good friends that talk about different ideas that, you know, allowed me to kind of like break out of that framework. And ultimately, you know, just to bring it back to the beginning, is to just be the best version of Sabo and express that as honestly as possible. And when I started doing that, and I'm not saying I have that perfected, but I do it much better than I did 6 months ago. And 6 months ago, I did it much better than a year ago. And it just seems like, you know, everything is falling in place now. I mean, my life's not perfect, but, you know, it's, you know, it's really good. It's really good.
And you can sense, like, you know, you can sense progress. I think that is more important than the benchmarks, because I think a lot of Western society thinks in terms of benchmarks, like these rites of passage, like, oh, you get through college, you graduate, you know, you buy cigarettes, whatever age you're at, you get married, but not the psychological development that is required to get into these stages. And that's where I feel like psychedelics and cannabis have given me this ability to pause and say, am I really at the stage that I think that I'm at? And what I mean by that in terms of development is like, am I psychologically fit to handle having kids? No, I was not, because I could barely take care of myself, right? Or was I able to even take care of, like, say, a few clients versus like having a, like I won't go on too many tangents, but I think for Asian American guys, they're just kind of told, okay, here's the path and take it. You're going to be happy. Even if you don't ignore those senses that say, I'm not expressing myself as a skill, right? It takes a lot of skill to be honest and be vulnerable. And you have to begin with little things like finding people who are somewhat like mine, and not even just expressing yourself, but hang out with them. Starting to get to know, or someone like I think we're an odd couple because we are a little bit more extroverted Asian people, and we're not afraid to talk to all different kinds of people. I've seen, and like I recognize in my own self, I'm like, Sabo is not afraid to talk to people.
Yeah, and you know what I kind of think is cool is, and not to just keep patting ourselves on the back, is that when I watched you being extroverted, you weren't like, you know, I think I had described to you, like, I really hated, like, those theater geeks that were always, like, just performing, you know? It's like, you know, telling jokes or just being very
dancing
gregarious.
Monkey. I used to be that guy, though. Dancing monkey, for sure.
Okay, okay. So, but kind of seeing, like, someone expressing themselves, being extroverted and interacting with people without carrying a lot of that, like, look at me, was kind of like a unique thing for me to see. And I mean, it's weird because I try not to see in color so much, but because of like my profession and what I do and the fact that it's rare to have an Asian CEO in the cannabis space, the topic keeps coming up over and over again. And in a weird way, it's almost like, not like PTSD, but I get reminded that, oh, this isn't normal, you know?
Yep.
And that,
yep.
I mean, it's normal in my private lives because I get to see how other Asian males act, you know, normally. But a lot of, like I said, you know, a lot of these guys that were like super interesting that I wanted to get in front of a camera and have them express their ideas never wanted to,
right?
You know, and I was like, is that ingrained by our culture, like, to be humble? I think I had told you, like, I didn't want to do this show because I thought other people would think I was like those, like, drama guys that wanted to be, you know, center of attention the whole time. And that really kind of messed with my head. And ultimately, I was like, well, why am I even, like, they pulled me back into, like, old Sabo, like, concerned about, like, what other people are thinking. And, you know, I had to remind myself, like, oh, just the fact I enjoy doing this, and we're trading good ideas, and maybe some people will benefit, and maybe if no one even does, who cares? Me and you had a good conversation, and that should be reason enough to do this, you know?
You know, it's funny you say that, because I do another podcast with a friend who will definitely get involved sometime.
Yep.
But we were inspired by Joe Rogan because he just said, I just felt like bullshitting. I just talked and it just turned into this thing. I didn't intend on it turning it, but he talks about some really important things. And, you know, as a comedian, you have to be aware of a lot of issues to make fun of it. You have to be self-aware enough. And that's, I think that's when you turn that lens inward. It's like, if I can't laugh at what I'm doing, I'm taking it way too seriously. Mm-hmm. And when I was like, in fitness, and I was like, I'm concerned with being important, helping people's lives because that's my contribution. It was just a roundabout way of giving myself attention.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, like, Brandon, you're doing great. You're pleasing everybody, and you're doing, you know, things that, you know, are good for everyone. But there's this lackluster element where I'm like, I'm not really being me, though. I'm not really expressing me to these people. They really wanted to see me. That's right. The only reason they spent time with me, because it gives them permission to do them. They want to express themselves physically. They want to have a good body because having a good body makes them feel good, and they, you know, they have less inhibitions about living their life.
Okay, so here's an interesting question. Is it sounds like just through life and chance meetings with people, maybe we inhaled some things or swallowed some things, and we came to these epiphanies. But I remember when I was young, I would hear similar things, you know, do what you're passionate about, be the true you.
Mm-hmm.
And I heard those things, I understood those things, but I still lied to myself. You know, like, how do you think one can cut through that? I mean, like I said, it took me till my daughter was born.
Mm-hmm.
When my daughter was born, it forced me to no longer think of, you know, what's good for me. You know, it forced me to think, like, this thing is 100% dependent on me. Every decision I make will either be a positive or negative benefit. I got to change some things. And that required me to be objective with whatever I was doing. And that forced me to, I think, really examine, like, all right, is this for bravado or is this just a part of your personality? Or, you know, all these different questions. And then ultimately, you know, my daughter is 6 now. And like I said, it's still a process I'm going through, but, you know, I have tasted, like, what it's like to be that true version of yourself. And I've also seen the reactions of people when I am being my natural self. And it's pretty awesome, you know, and I wish I was able to figure that out earlier as opposed to trying to be, like, you know, the funny guy that was, like, always witty, or, you know, the guy that could always crack, like, the, you know, most insane, racist, offensive joke to make everyone laugh.
The showstopper, right?
Yeah, yeah.
You know, let's go back to what you're talking about. Like, I think a lot of the humbleness is really not humility. I think humility is deference to the people who gave you the skills. I think a lot of Asian people in general have trust issues because, you know, like, I think it goes beyond this, but the Labor Exclusion Act that happened during the Gold Rush, that was the genesis of a lot of Chinese entrepreneurship, because we were not allowed to have jobs like that normal people had, and we had to take the side jobs and we had to make that our thing, like do laundromats or like do restaurants.
Yep.
And that documentary In Search of General Tso's Chicken talked about how Chinese people tried to help each other out with these associations that would train cooks, and then they'd send them off to these random places, but they wouldn't let them overlap, so we didn't compete with each other. So we had to work with each other, which is why I think a lot of Chinese people just say, oh, they're Chinese, just trust them.
Right.
Even if they're not necessarily. But, you know, the trust comes, like, we don't want to trust other people that are not Chinese, even though we are highly dependent on them. And in fact, we kind of envy them in some ways because, you know, the white privilege thing. I'm not going to blame everything on that. But we aspire to be like that because we know, like, that's actually going to get us things.
Yeah,
it's
going to
get us benefits, right? And women have been playing that game too in the corporate world, trying to be masculine and take over. But it's still this really childish game that's not involving humility. And I think that's because we lack elders to guide us and say, like, hey, dude, all right, it's time for you to stop acting like a fucking kid. And here's some really hard shit to do if you want to prove. You want to have sex and have kids. You got to prove you can handle what happens. Because every dude wants to get laid. Because it's like this validating thing.
Right.
It feels great. It's awesome. But what are you doing to get there? How are you getting that? I would take the easy way. The girls who were insecure as I was.
Right.
Like
right.
any, and that's how I ended up in tons of my relationships.
That's really interesting. You know, you touched on something that was really interesting, which is like, you know, or how did you delineate like humble from humility? Or did you delineate those two?
Well, I think that came with realizing a few things along the way, that it wasn't always about me. And I had a lot of people to thank for my success. But I thought it was because of something I was doing.
Interesting.
You know, but I had to trust them, right? And I came down to me realizing, oh, I need to trust this person if I am able to do better.
That's interesting. I mean, you know, this whole humility and humble thing, it's an interesting topic to me because this is one of the more recent things that I found out. Like, I've been playing mind tricks on myself with, which was, you know, every time someone will be like, this is an awesome vaporizer. And I'd be like, oh, and then once they find out it's me, I'll be like, oh, yeah, I was part of creating it, you know, and then just, you know, kind of like lower the importance of my part in the creation of it. Mm-hmm. And I think it was more of me wanting to make sure the person didn't think I was arrogant.
Yes.
Right? As opposed to just being me being proud of what I did. I should be proud, right? And I was like, that's so weird, like this fake humbleness, like, you know, I mean, probably in the big picture, it doesn't matter. But to me, it matters. And now that I've been just like, yeah, I created that. And, you know, I'm not cocky or arrogant about it. It's just the truth. You know, I made it. You know, it's no one's thinking. All these weird thoughts that I had in my head about how people may react if I said, yeah, I made it, was what I realized was just like when I see other people acting that way, that's how I, you know, felt how they were acting, you know, and extrapolated that to how people would react to me. And then that just goes back to, well, if you feel like saying something, just be your authentic self. If you're proud of this device, which you spent 3 years building that has won all these awards, why would you be, why wouldn't you be proud? Why would you act like your part in it wasn't that big, you know? And that was just kind of like where I was like, all right, I'm still sick, you know, there's still parts of me that are unhealthy. You know, I need to figure out, like, and I think part of doing this is part of the therapy, too, which is I'm doing some stuff that I wanted to do that I think I convinced myself I didn't want to do because of I saw other people's behaviors and then starting to do it again. But this time around, because I am just being myself and talking about things that I like to talk about or we like to discuss, you know, I think it's going to be much more well-received and we'll have a lot more. You know, I wouldn't be surprised if a couple of years from now, this is something big that, you know, maybe Asian males start listening to that eventually proliferates into other people that just want to be better versions of themselves or do some self-internal exploration to figure out ways to make themselves more happy with what they're doing.
It's funny. I think I'm going through and have gone through the same thing with humility where like I've done amazing things and I'm only now admitting like, you know, my own like part in it, my own responsibility. Like as I put in the effort, I should be able to say I had a part in that and be proud of it because like it's almost like, you know, like we deny that we're animals and when animals win, they always beat their chest. Like coyotes howl when they fucking get something.
Right,
you know, or like, you know, and guess what? The females notice that because they're looking for that because it means you put effort in and you're announcing it like, hey, everybody needs to know. It's different if you didn't actually do the thing and there's no proof and you just saying you did it.
Which is kind of like the norm, right?
Right, because you can
fake it. I was responsible for that.
Yeah. I'm an entrepreneur, you know, like that's why I think, you know, like this like online dating is so weird because you can say things about yourself and it can be unfounded. There's no way to check on it. But there are a few things that you cannot fake the funk in, and it's violence. Martial arts, you know, aggressive things, you have to prove it.
Right.
Always, always, always. And with guys, that's our proving ground. And I think it's healthy to accept, like, Bruce Lee talked about expressing your combative nature. That's why he did work with people, to help them do these things they wanted to do, like, aggressively. And it's like, we should own that Jet Li part of us. That part is just like, yeah, I fucking kick ass.
I mean, I think that's a really important thing because, you know, I've also noticed this behavior in a lot of my friends as well, you know, and it's kind of like, you know, I don't know if we were talking about this before we were filming or after, but, you know, I was like, I've been a lifelong slacker, you know, and I think for a lot of people that see me now, I mean, I haven't been a slacker probably since, like, my late 20s, you know, but
yep.
Let's just say for the first 30 years of my life, I got away with being just clever and I think resourceful because I'm small too, you know.
Yes, like, you have to be.
I think we
grokked that experience of like having to be the clever, not sneaky, but just like the person like, all right, well, do you really have to do that work?
Yeah,
and then
yeah,
now we're
exactly.
involved in things where we have to fucking work. Like, you got to work in jiu-jitsu. You got your brain, your joints, everything. You
right,
know?
Right. There's no faking. Like, I'm a black belt, and if you go in, there's no way
prove
you...
Prove that shit yeah. with another black belt. And, you know, and that's... I think testing grounds are very important because it humble you.
Yeah.
You start to realize, shit, it was my coach. It was the equipment. It was the gym. It was my buddies who... help me along who had a similar experience or the older ones who are like, dude, get your shit together. You can do this.
Yeah. So how do you kind of, you know, one of the other interesting things and, you know, one of the bad things I do is like when someone says something interesting, I really start thinking about those things. And, you know I'm in the middle of a conversation. I'm like, fuck. But one of the things that you said earlier that was super interesting to me was, I mean, I also believe we are a sum of, you know, everyone that helped us get to where we are.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, on the flip side of things is I know a ton of people that do the exact inverse, which is it's everyone else's fault except mine, you know?
Yeah.
And it's kind of like,
fuck you,
yeah.
You're cool.
When we do well, it's all about me. When we failed, it was all about other people. So, you know, I always thought like, you know, life is kind of like this really, really thin line of like understanding like, you got here because you have two entrepreneurial Asian parents that essentially, you know, made sure you had all the education you needed, blah, blah, blah. But also understand, like, well, even if you're born into a wealthy family, like, your mom doesn't go to work for you. You are still accountable for
you got
making yourself,
chance.
You know?
You got to take that chance.
And I always feel like people... I don't want to say people, but, you know, I've kind of myself have fallen into one or the other bucket. And only more recently have I been, you know, understanding like, oh, this success was because of all these people helping me. And also because I did a lot of this driving. And then also allow me to, when we do lose, not understand like, it was all because Sabo made this decision.
Yeah.
Whenever, you know, so.
Yeah, yeah. I decided.
Yeah, it's become, you know, I think a much more healthier way for me to live as well.
Well, it's also, too, you don't put that undue pressure when you do fail, because I think that is what gave me a lot of setbacks is when I think it was all my fault when I didn't do well in weightlifting. Sometimes you just fucking, are your body's just beat up and you just don't do well on that day, you know, and it just, you don't get to pick that. But I think the other factor, too, that I largely ignored is my, so Arnold Schwarzenegger talks about the two drives, humping and pumping.
Pumping and pumping, okay.
That's like, you know, those are the...
Pumping and pumping.
It's like, I ignored how big of a part that played in driving me to new places. The fact that I wanted to get laid and the fact that I wanted to feel powerful. That, just as an animal, I repressed that part of myself and ignored that what I call, like, your hidden knife. You can use your hidden knife to, like, hurt people or create things. You can break things down and... beat the shit out of people mentally, abuse them, whatever, or you can make something cool out of it. You know, and that's that tapping part of like kung fu.
So why do you think you suppressed it?
Because it's not cool to do that in Asian families. You don't talk about your, because that comes with feelings, man. You got to talk about these. I want to fuck girls. You don't have that conversation with anybody in your family.
Right,
like,
right.
Nobody talks about sex. Nobody talks about the fact that it created your life. And it's also going to drive you to do these crazy things. Like, why would I be on Snapchat? Because that's where girls are. I don't even like Snapchat. But that's where girls are. That's where they're paying attention. I have to know what they're paying attention to.
That's so interesting is that, I mean, I could pretty much, you know, we've, in a weird way, talked about, like, everything that shaped us. But pretty much, I would say every hobby I've had, whether rightfully or wrongfully, it being accurate or not, I thought that hobby would lead to more girls.
Yes! Oh, it's like even the potential, right? Just for the attention, because I don't think there's anything wrong with doing that, because we inevitably become a little bit better, and it drives us to those uncomfortable places,
yeah, yeah.
Right? We have to hang our brain on stuff where it's like, all right, dude, I'm going to do this, but it's going to get me this result. But sometimes you got to do things with no guarantees of any outcome.
I agree.
And it's hard because you can't talk yourself into it. You kind of just have to, like, I mean, there's, you just have to listen to your balls sometimes. And it's just going to tell you, go, dude. And that's scary because it'll go against what your culture has taught you, you know, like the conditioning that we go through. Like, I'm sure, like, you know, like hitting on girls is supposed to be scary biologically because it means you're really taking a risk.
Right.
And they're not always, like, we have access to so many attractive women. This is unprecedented. And they're actually, they don't have all these requirements like before, like arranged marriages or things like that. They just want a guy who's not stupid, who will have a conversation with them. That's all they really, really want.
The bar has gotten pretty low these days. You know, I find like girls that are especially kind of nearing 30 or in their early 30s that have, you know, dated a bunch of guys and kind of seen like the gamut of like what we do. Like they've met the nice guys.
They've
met
the aggressive. They call them fuckboys.
Yeah, yeah. And, you know, at the end of the day, you took the words out of, well, I don't have too many girlfriends now that I'm married. But, you know, I do remember, like, when I was still speaking with some of my single friends, and I was asking them, like, you know, well, what kind of guy are you looking for? You know, they're pretty much like, as long as the guy's not an asshole and can hold a conversation and has a job, you know, I was like, man, the bar has gotten low, you know. And I do believe it is because everyone is probably presenting a different version of themselves, and then the girl either likes them or doesn't like them because of it, and then as the relationship grows and they inevitably become their regular selves, you know, the disconnect starts to happen.
Right.
You know, that's my theory. That's my theory.
You know, and that's important to know is like how, like what we are presenting and when to drop that. And so, I read some Brené Brown after I went through...
Who is Brené Brown?
Brené Brown is an author, and she's a shame researcher.
Okay.
She wrote a book, and she really pushed the envelope on talking about vulnerability.
Okay.
Shame just being like, we don't talk about this stuff. We don't talk about our garbage or the stuff that kind of happened that went wrong in our minds. But when I started to acknowledge that there's a lot of things that I didn't process, that was holding me back after a big breakup. Because that's an opportunity to change my behaviors. Because that's one of them was just not understanding how to actually communicate. No one taught me how to communicate.
Yeah.
You know, like being vulnerable. And going back to modern dating now, for me, I have only recently been able to say, hey, I am attracted to you. I would like to get to know you. That statement in itself throws a lot of women off.
Right.
They're just like, the fuck is this chess piece? I don't... And I'm like, I want to have sex with you. It doesn't have to happen now. But I also want to get to know you. I realized, like, I can't have sex with strangers. That was a hard thing for me to swallow because that's what guys are supposed to be able to do. Fuck anything on command, anywhere, anytime.
Right.
That's the virility of your... And it's just silly because I know I have to know somebody because I am insecure deep down. I'm like, I don't know this person. This gonna see my naked body. I'm supposed to perform for them. And I'm in a performance art, weightlifting. I have to put it on the line. But even then, I still get nervous talking to like a woman I'm attracted to.
Right. Well, I think you know, I could see it in my daughter. When she shows me something and she senses like I'm faking a smile and it's not authentic, you know, she feels like I'm rejecting, you know, that piece of art that she's showing me. And
yes.
I think, like, you know, when you go up to someone, you want to buy them a drink, you want to dance with them, if they say no, there's no way to not take it. Or, I mean, it's really hard to not take it personally and not think of yourself as not, you know, not on the level of the girl that you just approached. And it's a mind fuck.
And, you know, I was watching you interact with Sophie, and, like, you had to go through these different, you're, like, asking her questions, like, what is this? What is that? You know, like, tell me what you need. And I think a lot of women cannot verbalize something, which is, they want safety. They want to have trust. And that is ultimately, I think, where a lot of release and inhibition happens, is when you trust somebody. And I was like, well, if they don't trust me, of course it's just going to be weird. Like, I was thinking, man, if I was a girl and people, like, if girls walked up to me and said, hey, I want to fuck you. Do it now. And I was just like, okay, without any kind of, like, and I realized that's essentially what guys are just saying. It's like, hey, let's suck.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's fine. Everybody knows that's eventually what needs to happen. But the legwork in the beginning is to get to know them as a person. Like, how did they, what are their desires?
Right.
And this goes back to, like, okay, not a lot of Asian men are portrayed as the love object because we're the servant, you know, in the back folding the sheets, doing right. the laundry. They were not taking the women and swooning them. But the hardest reality check for me is when women started to say, you're a fucking sexy Asian guy. I was like, don't. That is challenging my reality because I've always been not the hot Asian guy. What the fuck? I don't know what that is.
Right, right.
And then when people start treating me like that, I'm like, this is an identity crisis. You know, and I think a lot of Asian guys just, they just never allow themselves to think of themselves as attractive.
You know, definitely. I mean, I never had any trouble finding dates, but, you know, I definitely didn't think of myself as an attractive person, and I don't really think of myself that way anymore, but I have heard a few complimentary things here or there, and you're right, it is weird. I'm like, you guys talking about me? You know, 132-pound me? You know, and in a weird way, it was just like, why is it so hard to just accept a compliment, you know? And that's why I was like, there is some really just weird stuff that occurs when you grow up in a certain mind frame where, you know, basically, like, your type is shitted on as a kid, and then you have to build up, like, these defenses to deal with them. But when you're an adult, then you don't need them anymore.
When you lay that down.
Yeah, they start getting in the way, so.
And then there's no demarcation where someone's like, all right, cut the shit. Time to, like, stop all that boyish contrarianism. You know, where you just start doing things, you know, like, I did stuff because the other people are doing the other thing, so I'll do the other thing. And then, you know, there just comes a time where you're like, dude, just drop the fucking act. Everyone knows you were trying to prove yourself.
Yeah.
And you proved a point. You made it past that insecure point in your life.
Yeah.
But for a lot of guys, they never get past the wearing the cargo shorts and, like, fuck being fashionable point. And it's like, dude, you're only hurting everybody else by wearing those cargo shorts.
Yep. So we're going on about a good hour now. Why don't we kind of take the next 5 minutes to wrap it up? Because we talked a lot about a different
a lot of
range
shit.
Of topics. And, you know, one of the key takeaways for me in this discussion was, you know, how our lives changed when we were just able to be more of ourselves. So, yeah. You know, I guess, you know, I always think it's cool if someone just listens to this for shits and giggles, but if there's something, like, actionable that one person could do to kind of, you know, help themselves, like, you know, get to this self-discovery stage, I mean, is there kind of a suggestion or tip that you'd like to share with someone that helped you get to this point? Because for me, you know, I think the way we talk about it and the way I was kind of hearing it as we were talking about it, it sounds like, you know, we just woke up one day and was like, oh, it's time to be our yeah. authentic self,
yes,
you know?
Yes, yes,
but,
yes.
You know, for me, it was probably like a six-year process. And then after 6 years, I was like, oh, compared to that guy 6 years ago, I see quite a bit of change. But, you know, obviously there were small little steps that we took. So, I mean, do you have anything that you found super helpful that really got you to start, you know, challenging maybe some of your beliefs or some of the way you act and try to get more to your truest self?
There are two things. If you want to take the non-psychedelic sober route, the Enneagram has been the largest helping tool in understanding my personality.
So what is, I mean, I know what it is, but what is an Enneagram for those that are watching?
The Enneagram is just a psychological model based on a set of numbers from 1 through 9. And we have a dominant kind of number, and they have these qualities. And we have a version of ourself we act when we're under stress, and then a version where we're a little fuller. And that means, like, the one that, you know, is kind of full and complete and expressive to the people in your life. And it tells you a lot of things that you do that you may not be aware of under the surface, like the icebergs at the top and what's in the deep sea. And in the psychedelic realm, you know, cannabis and mushrooms, psilocybin mushrooms, have given me a pause to look at what I'm ashamed of and then start to change it in reality by talking about it. And that's honestly, just talking about it makes it okay for me.
Yeah, I love those suggestions, and those are really, really good ones. I mean, those are ones that I've used myself, and I'm going to come up with one that actually someone else told me that I think is really, really effective, and it's something that will be immediate, you know, like, and that is find 5 of your closest friends, give them a safe space, and ask them, what are 5 things that I do really good? What are 5 things that I do really bad?
Oh, and shit. That's good.
You have to give people the safe space to be honest. And when I had done it, and when pretty much everyone else that I've spoke to has done it, those things were way off. So it basically showed me everything that I thought about myself that were my strengths. Some of them were just like annoyances to people. And a lot of other things that I thought were like my weaknesses, people found like really charming and, you know, empathetic towards, you know. And I think that's the first way to really kind of like, you know, get some honest feedback about. Because, I mean, I'm guilty of this. When friends tell me like their problems or their girlfriend, their boyfriend, I always just side with them. And I'm like, ah, you know, like that guy's an asshole or, you know. But in reality, like, that's great for comforting them. But they never really learn. Like, the reason why you and your boyfriend are fighting or girlfriend are fighting isn't because it's all their fault. It's because there was some mix of like you two not agreeing on something, and you need to understand objectively what those things are in order to improve. And if we're just always there as support, then I don't believe they ever learn their lesson. So kind of my key takeaway, or my 2017 kind of like mantra, was be honest with your friends. Be the guy that tells them the stuff that they don't want to hear. And it takes courage to do that, I believe.
Yes,
you know,
sir.
It's much easier. Like, I like to be liked. You know, so for me, this is really coming out of my shell to be telling people things that they don't want to hear, and being okay with the fact that they may not like me as much, but it'll be better for them. You know, so that's kind of
that's
my tip.
I'm gonna. That scares me a bit, so I'm gonna do that because I honestly don't know like what they would answer.
And I think that's the exciting and scary part. And,
oh, okay.
Yeah.
Experiment.
And, you know, like, you were like, hey, go camping with us. And I was like, yeah, one of these days. I realized that was such, like, such a pussy answer of, like, yeah, I'll do it, but I'll be super vague about it. So, like, I never have to do it, right? So I was like, all right, we'll do it. We'll do it. You know, so, you know, getting honest with your – and, you know, once someone's honest with you and you know your tendencies, like, you know, just back to the Enneagram, like, I know a lot of people may or may not believe in personality tests, but I saw it more of, like, it just shows you your tendency type.
Tendency,
are you
yeah.
someone that tends to think negative, or someone that tends to think positive, or, you know, just once you understand your tendencies, then I think you're able to make changes. And and I believe that humans were blessed with this really incredible computer that could constantly be programmed.
Yeah.
And, you know, the programming is how much time do you spend, you know, letting something occupy your mind share. And ultimately,
yeah.
if it's negative stuff, then I believe you have a great factory of building negative emotions. And if you think positive, then it's the inverse. And ultimately, you know, when I started thinking about it in those terms, I was like, I really am. You know, like, forget about being the CEO of a company. Be the CEO of your own life. You know,
yeah.
once you do that first, then go to the next step. And, you know, that's my tip of the week or the month. I don't know how often we're going to do these. Hopefully often.
You know, in the next episode, I'll come back by doing that exercise. And then we'll talk about what I came back with for those 5 things.
Oh, shit. Okay, so what were your 2 tips again? And maybe I could do those while I'm gone.
Oh, well, you've already done them. Enneagram and cannabis.
That's right. That's
well,
right.
I would say, though, find out what you're ashamed of, because that's often what is hiding our gift.
Okay. So that's going to be my thing, is to do some thinking and think about what I was really shameful for that prevented me from kind of getting to this next level. So this is Sabo Shen with Vape Exhale.
Brandon Chin.
Hey, real quick, Brandon is a really, really good personal trainer. Not only does he train your body, I think if you guys enjoyed this conversation, you know, he could help also in different aspects of your life. So if someone wants to kind of get coached by you, how do they find you?
You go to theartofselfalignment.com. I'm trying to make it just my name as a website. It's a little bit cumbersome, I think.
Uh-huh.
But if you just search my name on YouTube, you can find a lot of my videos. They actually go into a little bit more psychology, mental traps we get into. I'm going to spend more time on the mental and emotional aspect of exercise now, because I think that's where most of the work is.
All right, so his name is spelled Brandon, and then last name is C-H-I-E-N, not C-H-E-N. My company is Vape Exhale. Usually I'm wearing some Vape Exhale gear, but we don't need to advertise my stuff. I'm just glad everyone stuck through the end. Would love to hear feedback, comments. We don't have a website or anything just yet, but I think this was pretty interesting. I was happy with it. What about you?
I want to do this again, man.
Well, I'm in Mexico next week, but back next Friday. Maybe
we could. Is that your way of evading me, really? Like, I'm sorry, I got Mexico. It's like, that's the worst rejection in the world. Like, sorry, man, I'm in Mexico, dude.
No, actually, so just real quick is me and my wife are getting away for 6 days. We're leaving the kids with my sister and my mom. So last year we took them to Italy, and quite honestly, that two-week vacation, I was way more exhausted coming back. So I was like, if we're going to vacation this year, Sabo needs to rest. And, you know, that's me being honest with the family. You know, I love my kids. I would love to have them there, but Sabo needs to recharge. And, you know, a couple days in Tulum, I'll see the Mayan ruins, and I'm sure I'll have some stories to share with you when I get back.
And you'll stop talking in third person, too.
Who?
Sabo.
Oh, and was I talking in the third person? My bad.
He needs a rest.
So I'm working on that humbleness now. All right, Brandon. That was fun, dude.
That was fun, dude.
Yeah, that was cool, dude.
I liked
an hour flew by, and actually I wanted to keep going, but you know, I kind of understood, like, fundamentally well, what you said, you know, like your feedback was people kind of wanted shorter, more digestible stuff. But
well, we can have a topic, like a just one word, and we can riff on that as long as it comes back to it, I think. And I can work on my facilitating.